Well, yesterday we covered some very important points regarding surrender or sacrifice. What we did was to give the metaphysical definition of the concept of surrender or sacrifice. Then the normal mundane understanding of what sacrifice is. Then the important question was, whom do we sacrifice to? The recipient, as we said. Is it a god? Is it a deity? An impersonal divinity? A human being or a guru? So we discussed that, who is the recipient of our sacrifice? Then also towards the end we said, what do we expect out of surrender or sacrifice? Some material gains, some psychological gains, some spiritual gains. What is it that we expect when we sacrifice to the divine or to the gods? Because normally there is an expectation, and through prayers we think that we'll benefit something. Well, the Gita and Sri Aurobindo tell us that yes, we can expect some things, and you may even get them from the divine. But then the highest and the greatest and the noblest and the most comprehensive would be to give oneself to the divine wholly and integrally. Because the argument is, why do you want to ask for the divine a small thing? Well, there are people, as we said, you go to temples and different places praying for small little things for our little benefits. But then Sri Aurobindo says, for to the soul that gives itself to him, God also gives himself altogether. Only the one who offers his whole nature finds the self. Only the one who can give everything enjoys the divine all everywhere. You see, this is the basic thing in yoga and sadhana. That's why Sri Aurobindo calls it integral yoga, because we want to, or we ought to, surrender our entire being. That means the physical, the vital, the mental, the subliminal, whatever the other parts we have. Because this is the way and the only way to get the integral divine. You see, when we say the word integral divine, we mean all the aspects of the divine. And by all the aspects, again, what we say basically in our ancient Upanishads, the Nirguna Brahman and the Saguna Brahman. We have different aspects of the divine, and Sri Aurobindo would describe it as the transcendent, the universal, and the individual. So most of these religions and yogis till now, or yogas till now, have concentrated on getting one aspect of the divine, or having one little glimpse of God, that his God is great love, or his great sympathy, or compassion, or power. All these aspects are there. But in Sri Aurobindo, he says, we want to realize the divine integrally. That's why he describes at great length in this book, The Mother, the four aspects of the mother. You see, these four aspects cover literally our entire life: wisdom, power, harmony, and perfection. So these are the four aspects that are there for our mind, for our vital, for the physical and for the soul. So the four aspects that we, our human beings, have are nothing but a reflection of the divine's four aspects. So he's telling us we ought to really surrender from our mind and life and body so that we realize the wisdom, the power, the harmony and the perfection aspects. So that is how he's told us, he tells us that only one who offers his whole nature finds the self. So this is what we had done yesterday, and today we will take up actually chapter 5, which is titled The Ascent of the Sacrifice One. I mean, one in the sense there are two series, first and second. And as I did yesterday, I will try to highlight some of the main arguments, main thoughts here. Now to continue our journey, after seeing what are the fruits of sacrifice and whom do we sacrifice, who is the recipient of sacrifice, now we come to the practical reality. We are the persons to sacrifice, I mean the human beings. You see, we have seen who is the God who receives, what is the concept, all that. But now Swayamvada takes up the practical issue of the human beings. What are they supposed to do? We said, okay, you sacrifice. But in what is exactly the process of sacrifice? How do we go about it? So here in this chapter, I don't know if anyone has a book, you come to chapter 5, the second para. But if this is to be the character of the rapid evolution from a mental to a spiritual being, contemplated by the integral yoga, a question arises full of many perplexities but of great dynamic importance. How are we to deal with life and works as they now are, with the activities proper to our still unchanged human nature? An ascension towards a greater consciousness, an occupation of our mind, life and body by its powers, has been accepted as the outstanding object of the yoga. But still, life here, not some other life elsewhere, is proposed as the immediate field of the action of the spirit, a transformation, not an annihilation of our instrumental being and nature. So slowly Swayamvada is bringing us to the day-to-day activities. So first of all, he is giving an outline saying that, you see, in integral yoga, we have three basic instruments, the physical, the vital and the mental. And these three are not to be annihilated or abandoned. You see, the old yogas tell us that the body and the mind and the physical and the emotions are to be abandoned. You seek only the inner realization of God, what we call the inner realization of the Atman. But then Swayamvada tells us in our yoga, in the integral yoga, mind, body and life are three instruments of the soul. This is a basic stand of integral yoga, that these three are only an instrument. So what do we do with these instruments? You see, we have so many instruments nowadays. We have the mic, we have computer, we have mobile, we have so many things. But you see, 100 years back, we were depending on a telephone. Maybe 300 years back, there was not even the telephone. So our means of communication was very little. But we have improved upon this means of communication, and today you have this internet and Wi-Fi and whatnot. So what has man done? He has improved upon this external instruments of communication. I mean, you can take anything, technology has gone so far. You have airplanes, you have trains faster than ever. So these are the instruments that we have done. But then the question is, have we done anything to improve the instruments of our own soul. We have neglected that. Of course, we are building better bodies, we are building better houses, but these are outer things. So Sri Aurobindo is emphasizing that we ought to perfect the instruments. That is why the integral education comes into picture. How you should develop your mind, your life, your body. That is the importance of physical culture. You see, everywhere there is a transformation of the instruments of the soul. What then becomes of the present activities of our being, activities of the mind, turned towards knowledge and the expression of knowledge, activities of our emotional and sensational parts, activities of our outward conduct, creation, production, the will turned towards mastery over men, things, life, the world, the forces of nature. Are they to be abandoned and to be replaced by some other way of living in which a spiritualized consciousness can find its true expression and figure? See, this is really very fundamental. You see, the moment we think of a spiritual life or a sadhana or a yoga, we tend to become ascetics. So he says, no, I'm going to Sri Aurobindo ashram, so I would be an ascetic, I would not like to do these things, I'll withdraw. But then, are we supposed to really withdraw from all these activities of life? That is the main question, because that's where people normally misunderstand the true sense of spirituality. The moment spirituality you want to do, immediately our mental makeup is so that we say, oh, these are non-spiritual, these are spiritual. Actually, it all began, these are non-religious and these are religious. There it is right. But when you come to spirituality, you cannot say this is spiritual and that is non-spiritual. But this notion of the religion has been carried over to spirituality. So what we are defining in religion, saying these acts are good, these acts will take you to God and these acts will not take you towards God. Our mind has been so much, you know, immersed in this kind of old thought, that we have dragged that old thought to spirituality, and here again we are doing the same mistake. So Sri Aurobindo is saying, are they to be abandoned and to be replaced by some other way of living? So here also, when we come to spirituality, do you want to do the same thing? That you want to abandon some works? Are they to be maintained as they are in their outward appearance, but transformed by an inner spirit in the act, or enlarged in scope and liberated into new forms by a reversal of consciousness, such as was seen on earth when man took up the vital activities of the animal to mentalize and extend and transfigure them by the infusion of reason, thinking will, refined emotion and organized intelligence? This is coming closer to spirituality. What is it? That we are supposed to do all activities of life, but with a change, with a reversal of consciousness. And he gives an example, activities of the animal to mentalize. You see, let us try to understand this. When man came upon earth, not the prehistoric man, the caveman, but the civilized man, what did he try to do in the beginning? He brought in the sense of religion. He brought in the sense of ethics. What was the main purpose of ethics? Morality. Even religion. The purpose was to harness, to control our vital. The vital that we have inherited from the animal. We said, you cannot let it go astray. You cannot be animal in the street, in the public. So your emotions, your passions, your expressions of emotions, all that was supposed to be curtailed. So in India we have certain ethics, in the West we have certain different ethics, in African nation we have different ethics. But the main idea was to control these vital acts, vital passions of man, which have been coming from the animal. So we say you should not do like that in the public. You should not dress up like that. All that is what? Purely to say that you control your vital being. Because we are very easily taken up by the animals, the physical vital. So wherever we are, you know, suddenly we get into wrath, we get into passions, we get into emotions, and we express that. And unfortunately nowadays, in the name of freedom and liberty, I've seen many examples in the West, there is no control over the vital. In the public they can do anything they want. They dress up any way they want. This is freedom. It's freedom and liberty. So we are thrown open. I think Mother once was talking about the hippies. You see, who have thrown out all the old, all the norms and religion and caste and morality and family rules and anything, all the structures of society, the hippies said, we don't want that. But the problem is what the mother says, they have not replaced it by a new. You see, when you walk on the floor, when you take the front step, then only the back step you take off the ground. You don't take off the ground both the steps. One, you have to be firm in front, the back one you take. And then the back one goes and takes a firm footing, and then the other foot. This is what we ought to do in life also. We should have something of the new consciousness. Then only you can take out the old. So what happened with the hippies? They had thrown to the winds all ethics and religion and morality. But a new spiritual consciousness was not there. So the whole society was thrown into great chaos. So this is what we are doing here. That is, we try to control the vital by the mental. And similarly, now he would say, from the mental you go to the spiritual. But try to control the mental with the spiritual consciousness. So he would say that just as we did during the animal stage, we have to have a reversal of consciousness. That means we have to find some inner strength, some inner footing. It is really wrong of the present generation to throw to the winds everything. Because in the saying we are modern youth, we don't bother about all that. It's a good thing. But then are these youngsters, the present generation, do they have a guide, a parallel consciousness where they say, no, I'm throwing out the old because I found the new. But they throw out the old and they don't have the new. That's why the present generation again is in chaos. And that is one of the things why institutions like ours, all over the country and the world, we try to keep this flame alit, the flame of the new consciousness. So that anybody, young or old, if they want to turn toward the new consciousness, something is available, somewhere you can go to. But not many come. But still, it is important to keep the light alit, the light of the new consciousness. Next, or is there to be abandonment in part, a preservation only of such of them as can bear a spiritual change, and for the rest, the creation of a new life expressive in its form, no less than its inspiration and motive force of the unity, wideness, peace, joy and harmony of the liberated spirit. It is this problem most of all that has exercised most the minds of those who have tried to trace the paths that lead from the human to the divine in the long journey of the yoga. Now this has been the main problem in front of the yogis or the sadhak. You see, one side they say there is Brahman, there is spiritual life. But on the other side, they see life full of suffering and pain and sorrow and violence and all the nonsense. So, what is the solution? How do we harmonize that? So, this was the basic question. You have two realities. One, the ugly reality of life, and the other, the possible golden reality of spirituality. Now, some people want this, others wanted this. So that was the great dilemma. You know, all our sadhaks, all our yogis, be it in the West or East, they were confronted with this problem. What happened to the Buddha? The great Buddha had these two options. Look at this life, old age, misery, death, sickness. So how can we come out of this? So that was the solution he was looking for. So out of this dilemma, there are many options for the human being. How do we lead your life? Number one, every kind of solution has been offered from the entire abandonment of works and life, so far as that is physically possible, to the acceptance of life as it is, but with a new spirit animating and uplifting its movements, in appearance the same as they were, but changed in the spirit behind them, and therefore in their inner significance. The extreme solution insisted on by the world-shunning ascetic, or the inward-turned, ecstatical and self-oblivious mystic, is evidently foreign to the purpose of integral yoga. Now this is where Sri Aurobindo is now giving us the solution. He said this dilemma was there. The Buddha, for example, he went out to meditate. He sat there for 6 years and then he got this enlightenment. He got the new message. Then he came back to the society and then gave the message, telling them that this world is full of misery and falsehood. It's best to come out of it. Then down the line, we had another great person called Shankara, who also had the same problem, the same solution also to the same problem. He said, okay, the world is full of misery. It's something negative. But not only is it full of misery, it is a falsehood. It's a dream, it's a maya, it's an illusion. So Shankara went one step ahead to say, it's not only a bad world, a world full of misery, but it is an illusion. You see, these were the great steps that have influenced the human life, at least in India. So for thousands of years, right from Buddha to Shankara to the recent times, what is the ideal of an Indian? Moksha. What is the ideal? Liberation. How do you get that liberation? Do these pujas, do these mantras, do these ceremonies, do these religious customs, and you will be guaranteed a seat in the moksha. Why did this come about? Because of the same Buddhist and Shankarite ideal that this life is a maya. So why do we want to live in this maya? Come out of it. And so they have given a path, a shortcut, they say. But then, is it really possible? We may admire Shankara's philosophy, but can we really follow it? To tell the truth, even Shankara could not follow what he said. Sri Aurobindo has a very good aphorism saying, the God laughed thrice at Shankara. I don't remember all the three, but one I remember is, two. If we thought that the world is an illusion, why did Shankaracharya go around the country spreading his message and establishing, in the east, in south, in west and north, that Pitha, the Shankaracharya's Pitha are there. Why did he go around the world? If he thought the world is an illusion, then why did he take the trouble of walking around this entire country? Secondly, he says God laughed second time when Shankaracharya came to bury his mother. Because his mother had asked him that, beta, you can go, you can become a sannyasin. But when I die, wherever you are, you have to come back and do the rituals. You know what we do in India. So he promised his mother and he literally came back to do the rituals of death. So Sri Aurobindo says, why did you do that? If you thought that is an illusion, and this death and mother's death and even the rituals which were not part of this illusory world. So what I want to say is, Shankara as a philosopher is extraordinarily great. There's hardly anyone greater than him. But can you follow Shankaracharya? It's not possible. So Sri Aurobindo is telling that one of the solutions was that absolute asceticism or the long sway of Shankaracharya's illusionism, or some people, they get into bhakti yoga. What Sri Aurobindo calls here ecstatical and self-oblivious mystic. You are lost in the bhakti for the divine. So you don't bother about the world. So the solutions were, you leave the world, it's false world, it's full of pain, Buddha. The other person said, it is an illusion, don't bother about it. And the best way to come out of this illusion, how do you come out of your dream? When you wake up, you have a new knowledge. Oh my God, this is my house. That was only a dream. That means something unreal. That means you have a new knowledge. When I wake up, open my eyes, knowledge comes in that this is my house. So Shankara said, by the path of knowledge, you will realize that this world is an illusion. The real truth is Brahman. So he said, that's the thing. And the third person says, don't bother about the world. It's only the divine who is important. So go to the temple and the church and just be completely lost in him. Do the puja, minimum physical maintenance you do. Do all those things. So these were some of the solutions. Either it was asceticism or a kind of bhakti part. And some others said, look, there could be, he says, for the same reason, the ethical solution is insufficient. There's another solution. Be ethical, be moral. You don't have to go to leave the world and this and that. Be a sattvic man, a good purusha, live a simple life. That's good. For an ethical rule merely puts a bit in the mouth of the wild horses of nature and exercises over them a difficult and partial control, but it has no power to transform nature so that she may move in a secure freedom, fulfilling the intuition that proceeds from a divine self-knowledge. Try to understand. I would like you to understand the main emphasis, why Sri Aurobindo discussing these things. First of all, this question of asceticism, of being ecstatic, all these are not wrong. Please remember, they have their place in human evolution. But then what is it that you have gained from asceticism, from being a great bhakta, by practicing all these things? Of pujas and ceremonies and rituals. What is it that you really gain? The best sadhak will get a glimpse of the divine. You call it atma-jnana or you got a brahma-jnana, whatever. You get a glimpse. But then your life remains the same. Sometimes your anger, your emotions, your passions, your bodily weaknesses, your bodily ailments, the great Buddha realized the great enlightenment, but are the Buddhists beyond the pain, physical pain? Don't the Buddhists die? It continues. So what Sri Aurobindo is telling us, these things have given you, as in a word he would say, our gain is only inward and our life in danger of becoming the dubious and ambiguous formula of an inner light doing the works of an outer twilight, the perfect spirit expressing itself in a mold of imperfection foreign to its own divine nature. So that is the tragedy, that is the weakness of all this asceticism and pujas and all that. That you are supposedly, not every man doing this pujas and being an ascetic has realized, but say there is 0.001% who has achieved something. Otherwise, 99.999, nobody achieves anything. We all do mechanically our pujas and this and that. But out of that, say, one in a million has realized something. So, what has happened? It's a blind mechanical following of these things, of all these outer activities. And then inwardly, there is some very small percentage which realizes the Atman. This is the result. Now, in this result, what happens? Even those who realize the Atman, we call them great saints and sages, even they have to compromise with the weaknesses, with the difficulties of the body. Nobody is there beyond the death and suffering and not only the body, the mental, your anger, your wrath, your passion, your egoism. None of these things are changed. You say, I've got a realization of God. But you may have realized God, you may have realized your inner being. But are you egoless? Don't you have anger? Don't you have passions? Don't you have emotions? So Sri Aurobindo is telling us that this Atman is still having to compromise and work with an instrumentation which is not changed at all. That is on the individual level. On the collective level, the sadhu or the sannyas makes no difference. He may gather around him 10, 15, 20, 40 people. That also is a kind of a semblance of a show. Do you think all those 50 disciples really realize what the Lord and what his master has said? Same thing with us, Aurobindonians. We have all turned to Mother and Sri Aurobindo, but have you realized what they have said? Younger people are coming, we are talking to them, telling them. But unless and until you practice, this theory of really an external thing remains the same problem. Be it Aurobindonians, be it Ramakrishna disciples, be it Shankara disciples, be it Ramana disciples, be it anybody. So what Sri Aurobindo is telling us is that outer instrumentation remains unchanged. Secondly, the society as such remains unchanged. The individual may benefit, but the society largely remains unchanged. So Sri Aurobindo's argument is, why are we doing all that? Neither you individually you gain, not as a society again. So he sees the fallacy of all that movement now. I remember what Sri Aurobindo said yesterday's reading. Everything has an evolutionary purpose. But today the times have changed or are changing. So we should not be fundamentally, dogmatically follow the old. We have to take to new kind of thinking. You see, basically, we have to think new. You see, we have to shed off some of this old mental habits first of all. Because it's only when your mind is convinced that you can transform your life. Why are we doing all these seminars at Sakar? At least to have a mental clarity of what is this new that Sri Aurobindo is speaking of. Otherwise, we are not a religion here saying, hey, you do this puja, you do this meditation 7 to 8, you do this. No. We are only imparting the knowledge of Sri Aurobindo so that some of us can be really mentally, we can take it, and if we are convinced, then we can practice ourselves. As I was telling the other day to somebody, the most important, the first thing is Shravana. At least hear, listen to what the new thought is. If you don't even listen to, how will you come to know that? And this Shravana has been there since beginning of Indian civilization. First, listen to the great spiritual masters. And then they say Shravana Manana. Then you have this kind of a reflection, analysis. I mean, you diagnose. You see the pros and cons. What Sri Aurobindo has said is like this, but Ramana says like that, Ramakrishna has said that, So then you have the time to analyze, if I can say, diagnose, and try to come to some mental conviction. Manana is from the mind. Mind has to be convinced. And then once manana comes, he says, Nididhyasana. Put it into daily practice, not just Sunday to Sunday or Tuesday to Tuesday. We do the pujas, you know, moonlit night or half moon and full moon and this year. And in India, we have got so many of this. We have got Navaratri and Shivaratri and Vataratri we have to. But we do that only on these specific days. But Indian spirituality said, no, it is Nididhyasana, daily practice. Because what you practice daily is really spirituality. What you practice on a Monday or a Tuesday and a full moon day and a Shivaratri and Navaratri, that is religion. So, Sri Aurobindo also would say, what has happened to the old is that. Now he takes the example of ethics. Ethics also is given as a solution. But what exactly is this ethics, morality? There's nothing one ethical rule. Every country, every culture has its own ethics. What is good here, may be bad there. What is good there, may be bad here. So ethics is a kind of a rule, a law made by the mind or the mental thinking of mental people who have had the religious sanction. So religion is behind you saying, no, according to Hindu dharma, you should do that. So you have taken the stamp and support of religion to your own mental rule. So that is why you say, hey, you should not do that. You are a Hindu, you are a Muslim, you are a... We don't say that you ought to do this for your own sake. You always say, in Hindu dharma, in Christian dharma, this should not be done. So ethics and religion are completely hand in glove. But today, as religion is fading off, ethics is not finding a support. In your own family, if you tell your children, if your brothers and sisters, don't do that, 50 years back, 80 years back, your family people obeyed you. Because you said, no, beta, apna ghar mein aisa nahi hota. In our Hinduism, we should not do that. I always quoted Hinduism. But today, because religion itself is now doubted, has lost its grip. So when a moral law is given, your own child will say, Papa, why should I do that? Now Hinduism says that. So what? What's big about Hinduism or Christianity? So you see, once the religion becomes weak, all the ethical law also has become weak. Because basically, what is ethics? Sri Aurobindo gives a very beautiful description. It merely puts a bit in the mouth of the wild horses of nature and exercises over them a difficult and partial control. You know what's a bit? Bit in the mouth of a horse. You know, when you go to ride a horse, you put a bit in his mouth and then the reins are there, you control. So the bit is there in the mouth of the horse, an iron rod, you know. And then the two ends are tied to the reins. So when the horse rider wants to control the horse, he pulls it and that hurts the horse. So that hurt, it immediately obeys and it learns to obey. So ethics is nothing but a bit in the mouth of the wild horses of nature. So similarly says man also has ethics as a bit. So he is controlled by religion. Because they say they push the bit into you and you should not do and you should do that. So that is a beautiful description. Ethics is nothing but a bit. And then he says, but it has no power to transform nature so that she may move in a secure freedom, fulfilling the institutions that proceed from a divine son, self-knowledge. You see, once you take out the bit from the horse comes back to his normal self. So too, ethics don't change a man. They give you a guard. a knocker garb, a dhoti, a Punjabi, or a kurta, and a white one. They say, oh my God, this man is so pure, wearing all the time white. You know, all this kind of interpretations come in. But ethics has no value, no spiritual value. It only controls your vital, your emotions. We say in the society you should not do this. We will say, at least in our Indian society, don't do that. When you go to America, you can do that. In the Western society, it's allowed. So these are all nothing but our control over the vital. But they don't change a man. They don't transform a man. So what's Sri Aurobindo's emphasis from all that? Nothing changes nature of man. Be it religion, be it ethics, be it this ascetic life, be it Shankarat life. These are all controls over our actions. Why are the controls? Because otherwise what happens? Society becomes wild. If I don't control my vital in the public, if I go and take this person, steal that thing, steal that car, it becomes chaos. If I go and, you know, tell something dirty to a person, we get into a fight and we... So what's happening? It's a complete chaos. So in order to bring some kind of an order, we need to control ourselves. Otherwise, if there's no order, the society goes wild. You know, there was a novel written by, I forget the name, Lord of the Rings. I read it during our MA days. That's a beautiful novel. I forget the author. The title is Lord of the Rings. Not your present, the serial is there. It's not that Lord of the Rings. That was a beautiful book. Where they show us, the author writes about a group of young children in their 10, 12, 13, 14. The oldest maybe 13 or 14 years. But there was a shipwreck, and unfortunately, the shipwreck, they were all, I mean, the ship was drowned, and these boys managed to get onto an island. So in the island, they don't know, there's nobody living there. It's a wild thing. So in the beginning, they are frightened, they are afraid of the jungle, they are afraid of the animals, and the younger ones are crying, and they say, I want food. You know, the whole things were there. They're trying to eke out their living. First of all, how do I live? Where do I live? How do I eat? Where do I drink? After this, very slowly, there's a change that is coming over the children. Now, there's nobody to tell them, don't do that, though there's no ethical law, there's no religious morality. So slowly, the natural things are coming out. You see, untampered human nature. That was a beautiful novel. It looks cruel, but the message is clear. So they become so very vital, so much violent, that to the extent that they kill one of their own children, a child of the group, as a sacrifice to a god of the forest. Exactly what we have been doing 50 million years back. But it's a very terrifying novel, but it's a fantastic novel to show that man left to himself, no adults, no morality, no religion, no laws, has basically this violent and vital nature. And so that has dragged on to that level. One of them becomes the chieftain, he starts controlling the people, then he says, behead that man because otherwise we cannot... All the nonsense comes forward. So ultimately they were killing each other, like the wild aborigines. And unfortunately, after a certain time, another ship comes, takes back whoever were there. So what I want to tell you is exactly this, that this ethics and religion is nothing but a control to have an ordered society. Nothing beyond that. If we don't have this control, we become like the children of the Lord of the Rings. So that is the thing that we see. But Sri Aurobindo's argument is, it has no power to transform nature. Nature means human nature. So the whole aim of Sri Aurobindo seems to be that we want human nature to change. Not just to say I want liberty, not just to say I want Atman. Even if you have that Atman realization, we are the same common human beings. A sadhu and sannyasin gets into the same problems. Mother once told us a story about, there are sadhus and sannyasins who go to the Himalayas. They live there 10 years, 12 years. Then she says, once they come back to society, what happens to them? Their vital comes out with a revenge. All these years they have not known what good food is, what is enjoyment, what is entertainment. That suppressed the vital. But once they come back to society, the vital is redoubled. There is no control and they have all that suppression comes out and becomes worse than common human man. Again, what does it show? You may withdraw for 10 years, but you are not transformed the vital. You may think I am a great sadhu, you have a long beard, you have this vastras of the sadhu, sannyasin sitting in a cave. But has that inner nature changed? Nothing. So Sri Aurobindo is again telling us, this or some similar device of self-protection may be necessary for a time, whether in ordinary life or in yoga. But in yoga, it can only be the mark of a transition, a fundamental transformation, and a pure wideness of the spiritual life are the aim before us. And if we are to reach it, we must find a deeper solution, a surer supra-ethical dynamic principle. To be spiritual within, ethical in the outside life, this is the ordinary religious solution. But it is a compromise. The spiritualization of both the inward being and the outward life, and not a compromise between life and the spirit, is the goal of which we are seekers. This is the aim of Sri Aurobindo's yoga. The old yogas, it is very clear that to be spiritual within and ethical in outside life. You see, you go to a saint and say, hey, Guruji is a great spiritual master. Why do we call him a great spiritual master? We say, nay, he is Atmajnani. We say he has realized it. How do you know that he has realized the Guru or the Atman? Because the person says, look, I have realized the Atman. Yesterday I was sitting in the forest and suddenly I got the realization. People believe him. And then the ethical life outside. But a sadhu also has to behave in an ethical, moral way. He should not be eating like a glutton. He should not be running after women. He should not be doing discomfort. He lives a simple life. In fact, this simplicity is simplicity of living is again an exaggerated thing. The moment you want to become spiritual and immediately you say, I've got to be very simple. A young man had come to Saka to work here. He says, sir, I am a very spiritual man. I said, why is it? Because I won't sleep on your cot, I won't sleep anything, I want just a mat, no pillow, I want only one bottle of water. So he thought that he, just by sleeping on the mat and sleeping with the puja of water, so he thought this kind of a simplistic life will make me ethical or religious. But within 6 months, he fell in love with somebody. And one day he took courage and told the girl that I'm in love with you and I want to marry you. The girl turned around, luckily didn't slap him. But exactly, that's what we are driving at. Your external so-called simplicity and show has not changed anything with you. Your passions, your emotions, your human love have remained the same. So why do you want to make a falsity and said, look, I'm sleep. If you go to his room, he says, I'm only a sleeping mat, no pillow. So these are some of the hypocrisies of human nature. So what Sri Aurobindo is telling us is exactly this. Don't be hypocritical. Be natural. So that is the ideal of outside. Normal life is spiritual within, ethical outside. But in Sri Aurobindo, I would say, spiritualization of both the inward being and the outward life. So with Sri Aurobindo, there are two things. inner realization of God and the outward transformation of your nature. So that is why Shravinda's yoga is difficult, because he is insisting that there should be a play of the outer also. You see, I should be able to go to hockey, I should be able to eat well, I should be able to drink well, I should be able to sleep well, have comfort. I am not denying this. But at the same time, I should have a different consciousness. When I have an AC or a TV, I should not say, oh my God, I'm ready now, fine. But the day AC is gone, don't cry. When there's no electricity for 2 hours and your favorite Gujarati and Hindi and Tamil serials is not there, then you make a fuss. So this is what is wrong. You have to have this equality. You can enjoy life, but with an equanimity. So Sri Aurobindo is telling us, let us have this transformation of both inner and outer. Nor can the human confusion of values, which obliterate the distinction between spiritual and moral, and even claim that the moral is the only true spiritual element in our nature, be of any use to us. For ethics is a mental control, and the limited erring mind is not and cannot be the free and ever-luminous spirit. It is equally impossible to accept the gospel that makes life the one aim, takes its elements fundamentally as they are, and only calls in a half-spiritual and pseudo-spiritual life to flush and embellish it. Inadequate, too, is the very frequent attempt at a misalliance between the vital and the spiritual, etc. These are all stumbling solutions of the infallible human mind, groping for a transaction between the high spiritual summits and the lower pitch of the ordinary mind motives and life motives. Whatever partial truths may be hidden behind them, that truth can only be accepted when it has been raised to the spiritual level, tested in the supreme truth consciousness, and extricated from the soil and error of the ignorance. So that is the concluding remark from Sri Aurobindo, that because the ethics is a mental controlled and the limited erring mind is not, cannot be the free and ever luminous spirit. So we are driving towards the last summary note, that mind which has been the most predominant instrument of man till now, what has it given to man? Religion, ethics, morality. It has done its job well, but in the present times there is something else that has come into picture, something beyond the mind. Not everybody can understand that, but Sri Aurobindo says this is the time, the age, where spirituality, the spiritual consciousness is coming into human life. So this little mind, it may be a great mind, you may say, my shastras have written. But shastras also have a time element about that. What was then truth perhaps may not be truth now. Manushastra has also degraded women. It's not that we in Indians don't have scriptures that have degraded women. Manushastra has done that. But do we say, Manushastra says women should be like that and men are superior? No more. Times have changed. We cannot degrade the women. So what I want to say, even if it is written in the Shastra, times have changed. A new spiritual consciousness is coming. You see, all the strikes that you see in Delhi and Bangalore and all that, recently there have been so many demonstrations. Why is it happening? You think it's just a political thing or somebody is doing a BJP or a Congress? No. It is the spirit of the new age that is coming in, where there is equality, where there is freedom, where there is... These are the values of a spiritual life that are penetrating the society. You may call it a women's right bill or a women's rape bill or whatever. These are all the external things. But spiritually, it's a new consciousness that is setting in. And so, thousands of youngsters, days together, they can march in Delhi, Bangalore, Calcutta, Gujarat. Spontaneously. Why is it that 50 years before it never happened in India? Because it's 1956 that the supramental came. There's a new consciousness is pervading. Slowly is entering our collective life. There have been individual sadhas like Pavitra and Nolini and Champaklal. They've gone up. But supermind is not meant for 5 or 10 or 12 sadhaks. It's meant for whole of humanity. So Mother did tell us that when the supermind comes, there will not be catastrophes, there will not be tremendous revolutions. You see, in the West till now, we have had everything through revolutions. The French Revolution, the Russian Revolution, the Irish Revolution, the Indian Revolution. We wanted to throw the old out through revolutionary movements. But today, there is no revolution than catastrophes. It is through the young minds that it will penetrate, and the young minds will change, will break the mold of the old. So without, she would say, it comes in very stealthily, without disturbing much, and one day you see, the whole thing is turned around, turned over. So this is the stealthy working that will take place. So that is how Sri Aurobindo is telling us, that we have to have a new law, something else that really controls us. And these human efforts may have a partial truth, but now is the time of the truth consciousness. Truth consciousness means the consciousness of supermind. So that has come, and only those who are open to that new consciousness. Open in the sense, well, to be frank, I don't know if I am open to the truth consciousness. But yes, at least mentally you do not deny the coming of the new. Mentally I am saying. Because most of the persons in the world, you speak to them about the new consciousness, about the new spirituality, they saw the new age consciousness, the new age society, the new age movement, the new age music. We are not talking about the new age, which is still again something of the mental. So what we need to see is that mentally, at least, we do not make it a block for the entrance of the new consciousness. So all our efforts at Sakar, all the seminars here or there, is at least to break the mental resistance. So all the Aurobindonians at least have had this kind of a gain and achievement, that they have mentally accepted the new consciousness. If you go and speak to somebody across the street, they'll say, what are you speaking about? What is this Superman age consciousness? Now, we are all nice, and on 25th we have Masimagam, we have 100 gods coming, we are decorating our house, preparing our... So they want to follow the whole tradition. They say, don't speak to us about all the new things. We don't believe. But call an Aurobindonian, he will say, yes, I don't know what supermind is, but I know Mother and Sri Aurobindo have brought down, and it will take some time, some centuries, but it will come one day. If you can say this sentence, you are already progressed a lot in your sadhana. But in order to say that, you must know what supermind is. You must be able to read it. Because some people say supermind means supra mind, great mind, brilliant mind. Brilliant mind is not supermind. So what we see is what Sri Aurobindo is telling us, that we need to have, the word that he uses here is a super consciousness. Yes. So we... I'm forgetting one word here. Well, whatever. The word that I'm looking for is where Sri Aurobindo tells us that no solution offered can be anything but provisional until a supramental truth consciousness is reached, by which the appearances of things are put in their place and their essence revealed, and that in them which derives straight from the spiritual essence. So this is the point where we can conclude about conclude the discussion about what is it, what are the solutions given by humanity till now, and what is the solution that Sri Aurobindo is giving us. Solution of this life, of human life. Do we want to follow the old track? Get into a kind of a backward movement. In fact, we are supposed to be in the fast forward movement. Superman is a fast forward movement. But instead, in the name of Hinduism, in the name of rituals, in the name of Islam, his name, thousands of years our people have done that. This is all, as he puts it here, everything has its own place, its own time. But what Sri Aurobindo has brought up is a new consciousness. Are we ready? Remember Mother's message? Are you ready to collaborate? That was long back in the 60s, she had asked humanity, are you ready to collaborate? In fact, it is from 69 when the new consciousness descended, not the supramental, but a consciousness lower than that, that the mother has told us that the new consciousness has come in 1969, 1st of January. And from there, people are being divided now. Those who are with the past, those are with the future. And Mother and Sri Aurobindo make it very clear, if you are not moving toward the teacher, the past will be obliterated. You know, the famous pralaya is already taking place. It is sieving out the old and the new. In fact, Sri Aurobindo goes to the extent of saying, even if a religion, any religion, to the extent of even Hinduism, if it doesn't move forward and open itself to the supramental consciousness, it may be dumped in the dustbin of nature. So the future is so strong, so uncompromising, that not only individuals but nations and religions, they'll all be dumped by nature. I mean, they'll become fossilized. So our individual effort, at least I cannot change religion, I cannot change nation, but at least I can change myself. So I can make a choice to be with the past or to be with the future. You do not know what is the future. But at least in your mental decision you say, no, I am with the future. Whatever it means. And I will not follow the past as much as possible without disturbing my little environment. Because I am not a great Arjuna that I can fight the society. But without much disturbing, if I can stealthily bring in the new consciousness, be a channel, we would have done our work. So, this is a personal choice. You want to follow the old and be petrified. Petrified means be solidified, become crystallized, become like a stone that really doesn't move. Or make the first baby steps towards the new, holding the hands of Mother and Sri Aurobindo. Because that future towards which humanity is moving, the only hand that can help us is the hand of Mother and Sri Aurobindo. Why is it I'm telling only a hand of Sri Aurobindo and the Mother? Because they are the harbingers. They are the ones who have brought it down. So who can be better guide than Mother and Sri Aurobindo towards the new supramental? One who has brought it. One who has got it for mankind. So there may be thousands of other gurus there. Well, Tompi, it's fine. But if they're all gurus who are, you know, as we say, tinkering the old religion, very well, you can go. But Mother told us in the classes that we are here to do something new. What mankind has never ever attempted. So in this new, there is struggle. Somebody goes down, somebody goes up. But at least she was very clear, be it in education, be it in sadhana, be it in life, be it in anything. She says, our firm faith is to do something new. What that new is exactly what is there in the synthesis, in the life divine, in Savitri, in their works. So, read them whenever you can. At least let the mind break its shackles, its prison house, and come out into the open. Well, we'll take a break now. After this, there's another session, what I promised yesterday, about the psychic being, which is one of the most beautiful passages. We'll take it up after the break.
Well, before taking up the the passages on psychic being. I think I would like to give you a little more background before we come to the main discussion. So with all this uncertainties of the ethical law, the religious law, we said we have to move towards a spiritual consciousness because that is the only law that insists on a change of human nature. No other activity of human life changes human nature as much as spirituality. But remember, friends, spirituality is not the one that we commonly know it to be in India or elsewhere in the world. By spirituality, we mean the integral yoga of Sri Aurobindo. That is the connotation I give to spirituality. So it is that kind of an integral yoga spirituality which really emphasizes on the transformation of human nature. So Sri Aurobindo says here, in the meanwhile, our only safety is to find a guiding law of spiritual experience, or else to liberate a light within that can lead us on the way until the greater direct truth consciousness is reached above us or born within us. For all else in us that is not is only outward, all that is not a spiritual sense or seeing, the constructions, representations or conclusions of the intellect, the suggestions or instigations of the life force, the positive necessities of physical things, are sometimes half-lights, sometimes false lights, that can at best only serve for a while, or serve a little and for the rest either detain or confuse us. So he is now moving towards this central solution. The general solution, we have said, is a spiritual law. Because he says, in this spiritual life or spiritual law, we need to have two things. One, find a guiding law of spiritual experience. That means you yourself find your own spiritual life by an inner experience. You don't have to read books, you don't have to go anywhere, you don't have to go to the ashram, nothing. Like it happened exactly with Sri Ramakrishna, Sri Aurobindo, Ramana, especially with Sri Aurobindo, I can tell you that he did not follow any Vedas or Hindu or Buddhism, I mean Upanishads or the Gita, nothing. He practiced on his own, whatever the way he did. But first he experienced the law of the Vedas or the secret of the Vedas. About the secret of the experiences, as most of you know, and all these experiences that came out in him when he was in Gujarat near the Narmada River, he sees the Kali temple, and from there he sees has the vision and darshan of Mahakali. In Kashmir, he has experience of Nirguna Brahman. In Baroda again, he sees the inner divine coming out, the Atman. So these experiences, for which he did not really sit down and read books and libraries of books, no. And when he started practicing himself, he found out the secret of the Veda. That means the Vedic consciousness, the Vedic gods, the Vedic Brahman. And it is only after having this guidance or this experience, then he said, I know now what am I supposed to do in this world, what work am I supposed to do.
This is exactly what the Bhagavad Gita also tells Arjuna. Shri Krishna tells Arjuna. The first, the word is, I think if I'm not too wrong, stationed in me, you act. Stationed in me means realizing me within, then you act outwardly. All your outer actions must be a reflection of the inner. That's what the Gita said. And Sri Aurobindo also says the same thing. He has first the spiritual experiences, and then he writes, and then he enters into politics. Then he comes to India, into Calcutta, West Bengal, and then he starts the movement. So we see that here is a man who has found his own spiritual guiding law. We have the famous example of Raman Maharishi also. He was a young boy, young child of 7 or 9 years, who hadn't read anything about the scriptures, nothing. He has just an inner call of Arunachala mountain. He goes there, sits on the top of the mountain, gets into meditation, and there, with a rocket speed, he reaches the Brahman consciousness. After that, when he comes back to the ashram, then he tells you a bit of philosophy of the Vedas and the Vedanta. So what we want to understand is, one is that you have had great experiences, find your own guidance, and then you act. The second option is, or else to liberate a light within that can lead us on the way until that greater direct truth consciousness is reached above us. So second way is to liberate a light within. Now this is what we are going to take up a little later. But this is the option. One is the spiritual experience. The other is the release, realize the light within. And what is the light within? It's the psychic being. You see, it's so clear. So that psychic being can be a true guide to your life. So here, for all else in us that is only outward, the guiding law of spiritual experience can only come by an opening of human consciousness to the divine consciousness. There must be the power to receive in us the working and command and dynamic presence of the divine Shakti and surrender ourselves to her control. It is that surrender and that control which bring the guidance. But the surrender is not sure. There is no absolute certitude of the guidance so long as we are besieged by mind formations and life impulses and instigations of ego, which may easily betray us into the hands of a false experience. This is again a very beautiful note of precaution. You see, this inner experience or the spiritual experience, for that there must be a kind of, he says, an opening to the divine consciousness. Now, what do we understand by this opening to the divine consciousness? We can all say we are all open to the mother's force, the Shivamdas force. Opening, you open the door. What do you do to open the door? You can't just push it open. There are bolts on the ground, on top, on the side, which are locking the door. So first you unlock the door, then take out the bolts, take out the lock. Then only if you push the door, it will open. Similarly, in human nature, we have a lot of these locks and blocks created by our ego. So this ego is the lock, it is the block. So unless and until we remove the ego, we thin down the ego, our doors cannot be opened towards the psychic being. In one word, it's purification.
unless and until we follow the path of that purification, we cannot open the door. We may have aspiration, and in fact yoga begins with aspiration, but an aspiration not for anything mundane, an aspiration for a higher consciousness. That's number one. Aspiration takes you till a point, but afterwards you are not able to go beyond. You are saying the same thing, you are praying the same thing, telling the mother same thing. But why is it that you feel blocked? Precisely because there is no purification, or what Shravaka says, rejection. If there is no rejection that accompanies aspiration, you cannot reach higher levels. So then we see sadhana means purification. It means rejection. You ought to be practicing that. Otherwise, don't. So, but in this purification, how much can you purify yourself? How many things can you reject yourself? You see, if you really want to reject and be pure, it is very, very difficult. Because there is so much of darkness and falsehood and ego within us, that is not possible. Humanly, it is not possible. I mean, we see the ego there, sometimes it is a sattvic ego or a rajasic ego or a tamasic ego. Sometimes we don't even see our own ego. So you may say, you see, now I am pretty sattvic, I don't get angry, I am telling the truth and I am dressing properly, eating little, sleeping on the mat. So you see, now this is what, but we didn't even say sleep on the mat. Yesterday, did we not see Sri Aurobindo is telling us, why are you suffering your body? Reject that greed and that passion and that impurity and that falsehood of your vital nature. So that is the purification. So that is difficult. Then what do we do? We just keep aspiring, go to samadhi, go to meditation hall, go to your centers from wherever you are coming, and we do mother's birthday, Sri Aurobindo's birthday. I mean, I want all of us to really ask the question. In our centers, be it somebody was coming from Guwahati, somebody is coming from Calcutta or Delhi. We go to these celebrations. But then, what do we do? Is it that you are making a ritual out of this? If you just go, nene, वहाँ पे मेरा सेंटर में शिव अरविंद का जन्मदिन है आज मैं जाकर आ रहा हूँ. It's nice to say you have good feeling about it. Yes, माता जी का जन्मदिन मैं जाकर आया पांडिचेरी आश्रम. Like the famous man who jumps into the Ganges. Before jumping into the Ganges, he puts his clothes on the shore, takes a bath. He says, I'm so pure. And he comes back, puts on the old clothes. So Ramakrishna said, what has happened to this man? In the Ganges, he thought he will become pure. But once he's out of the Ganges, this old clothes have come back to him. That means the old habit, the old prejudices, the old thinking, the old impurities. So that's exactly my question. You all come for Pondicherry, we all go to this center, we all do. But what have we done with ourselves? हाँ भाई पांडिचेरी जाकर आया दर्शन के लिए. क्या करें भाई आप? खर्चा करें, कोई ट्रेन पर आया, कोई फ्लाइट पर आया, कोई बस में आया, कोई गाड़ी में आया. बट माई फंडामेंटल क्वेश्चन इज वॉट आर वी डूइंग विथ आवर सेल्स. देन वेर इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन आवर सेल्स एंड दैट मैन हु गोस टू द टेम्पल ऑन संडे एंड चर्च ऑन फ्राइडे. आई मीन वी हैव गॉट टू डू सम कॉन्शियस थिंकिंग. That unless and until we are really making an effort, these external satisfactions lead us nowhere. So one has to be very, very clear and strong. Otherwise, बोलते हैं हाँ मेरा पिताजी बुरा मानेंगे. क्यों? Because I have not been to the darshan.
अरे यू आर डूइंग इट फॉर द सेक ऑफ योर फादर, फॉर द सेक ऑफ योर फैमिली. सो दैट इज द ब्यूटिफुल थिंग हियर, एस्पिरेशन, प्यूरिफिकेशन और रिजेक्शन. बट प्यूरिफिकेशन और रिजेक्शन एज आई सेड यू कैन नॉट डू. यू विल जंप इनटू गैंजेस 20 टाइम्स अ डे बट यू प्यूरिफाई विल नॉट बी. Then what can do the purification? How can you do the purification? The only key, the golden key, is called surrender. So we come back to the famous word of sacrifice, that it is only the process of surrender. So Sri Aurobindo writes that there must be the power to receive in us the working and command and dynamic presence of the divine Shakti, and surrender ourselves to her control. It is that surrender and that control which bring the guidance. A beautiful thing. So in a way, Sri Aurobindo's yoga is easy and yet difficult. Because he is asking us to do only one thing. No meditation, no pujas, no tapasyas, no rituals, no rhymes, no ceremonies, nothing. I mean, imagine how simple he has made our life. Nothing of the external. If you don't want to go to some mother's room tomorrow, don't go. You don't have to. Because if you are taking it as a ritual, there's no fun. Makaru to bahut baar dekha hai, mera room. I have got a good photograph also. So we can do that. We can go here and there, but there must be that inner urge. Andar se there must be a kind of a call. Haan bhai, 21st, 21 February is Mata Janamdin, chalo jaakar aayega. People go to Makkah, we go to Masjid, we keep going to your, that, what is that, Kumbh Mela. Hum kyun jaate hain Kumbh Mela? Why do we go there? Ganga mein dip karne ke liye. Biologically, if you see 4 crores of people taking a dip in that, it could be the dirtiest of water that you can never dip in. Jante hue hum jate hain kyon? Maha, this thing, we have a great tradition in India. For centuries we have done that. I mean, everything is right, but are you and me who turn to Sri Aurobindo, are we wanting to go to Kumbh Mela? Are we wanting to go to this place or this room or that room? It's a big show, Kumbh Mela. Well, organizationally they have gained a world renowned, that there's the best management in the world. All that's fine. But spirituality is a serious business. No showmanship, no external paraphernalia, nothing and nothing and nothing. Because it's you and God. I don't want anybody or anything or any structure or any ism or any ritual. And that itself gives you such a great sense of liberation, that I don't have to depend on the outer. I'm depending on myself because the divine is within me. So Sri Aurobindo says, the only way is a surrender to her, to the divine Shakti, and which will bring the guidance. But the surrender is not sure. There's no absolute certitude of the guidance so long as we are besieged by mind formations and life impulses and instigations of ego. And how will you surrender? I mean, I think next time you come, you practice this a little bit and let's share. So what is the meaning of the surrender? I give to the mother. What do you give? You give her a chocolate from your pocket. He says, unless and until your mind formations and life impulses and instigations of ego, that is the process of purification. So we have mind, mental prejudices, mental formations, what we call the mindset. You give up all that. Give up means don't say, oh, I don't believe anymore in the rules of the ashram, I can go to the dining room, just walk in and tell. No, again, that's disorder. So these are not mindset, these are external management orders that you follow, because as I said, otherwise society is in chaos. But what he's telling us is that these are, whatever is the besieged by mind formations. And this mind formations is the one that we are stuck up with our shastras. stuck up with our mantras, stuck up with our rituals. He said, these are the mental formations. I mean, there with Hinduism, with Christianity, with Islam, every one of us has a mindset here. I mean, it's so concrete that we have become concretized ourselves. We don't want to change. And then he would say, life impulses, there is also life impulses. In my life, I'm used to living like that. And my life impulses, you know, this is my desire. This is my requirement. So, and then instigations of ego, which may easily betray us into the hands of a false experience. Again, the question of ego. And you see, you have painted yourself in such golden colors that you don't even see your own ego. You know, the long before my MA days, I read a book called The Picture of Dorian Gray. A lovely novel. The young man who has his picture painted by a beautiful artist, a big life-size one. And there the man is handsome, beautifully clad, and really a wonderful looking young man. He keeps that right as soon as you enter the door, right in front, so that anybody who walks into his house, this is Mr. Gray, Dorian Gray. And whenever he comes, most important, he comes and he sees himself as if in a mirror and says, wow, that is me. So he always thought that that beautiful figure is me. But years passed. It's not just the body changes. But in these years, he has become completely not only kosher, non-spiritual, immoral, unethical, irreligious, and all the dark things that were there. But he would drink and booze and do all the dirtiest, immoral things. When he comes to the house, he sees this picture. He says, oh, that's me. But inwardly, he was becoming corrupted. His consciousness itself was getting corrupted. But he didn't see that. He was thinking, this is the man. So what Sri Aurobindo is telling us is this external ego. We all have a painted image of ourselves. That is why that novel hit me long back. The way really we all have a picture of ourselves somewhere in our mind. That I'm like that, my quality is like that, my voice is like that, my features are like that, my character is like that. We have all a picture of Dorian Gray. But that is a false, what Sri Aurobindo is telling us, that it gives a false experience. So let us not be bound to our own picture of Dorian Gray, the picture drawn by our own ego. This danger can only be countered by the opening of a now nine-tenths concealed inmost soul or psychic being that is already there but not commonly active within us. That is the inner light we must liberate. For the light of this inmost soul is our one sure illumination so long as we walk still amidst the siege of the ignorance, and the truth consciousness has not taken up the entire control of our Godward endeavor. You see, this is the what Sri Aurobindo is telling us. Going beyond these mental images, vital images, go within. And there's somebody called the soul or the psychic being, which, as it says, is nine-tenths concealed. It's all deep within. You know, we go to our Indian temples. The deepest part of the temple, where we say Garbhagriha, that has the image of the Lord, the statue of the Lord. But before reaching that Garbhagriha, you have to go through so many doors, big and small. So too, our soul is hidden in that Garbhagriha, but there's a long passage. You have to go so many doors. And these are the doors of our own inner being. He says, that must be liberated. That will be your guide. Until and unless you have what he says, the supramental consciousness in you, The psychic being is the only guide to your life. Rest of the all the other things, including the scriptures, including your books, including everything, may be misguiding you. In the sense, it's not that the Gita itself is wrong, but I interpreted it according to my capacity, according to what suits me. So he would say, keep that soul, that is the only guideline. And then in the transition, there may well be a period. Now, this is very important for those of us who want to practice. In order to reach the inner soul, how do you go about it? Very simple, pragmatic rules. Okay, we have decided that I don't have this experience of the Vedas and the Sri Ramakrishna said and Ramana said. But let us decide to go to the psychic being. That is the surest guide. How is it that psychic being is the surest guide? Because it is a direct amsha, part and parcel of the divine himself. So psychic being can never go wrong. But now, it's not so easy to get the psychic being too. So there is a process. There is a methodology. So here he would say the three steps are, in the transition, there may well be a period in which we take up all life and action and offer them to the divine for purification, change and deliverance of the truth within them. This is step one. What is it? Take up all life and action and offer to the divine. The very first step is every action, every thought, every feeling, good, bad, false, untrue. Because of our ego, we do a lot of wrong things, bad things, untrue things, false things. But include all that, and offer. Offer it whenever you can remember. You see, suddenly I'm going to the garden, I may remember the mother and say, Ma, last 1 hour I've been taking class. It's for you. You have been going on the seashore and you look at the sun and say, wow, what a beautiful is the face. It's like the face of God. And then you remember the mother and say, Ma, this morning walk also is an offering for you. So every act, whenever there is a moment of inward stepping, which must be done a lot more. But we are common people. We are eating, we are drinking, we are playing, we are talking. There's not much time when we really dip in. Unless you go to the samadhi, in the meditation hall, Matri Mandir, you go there to dip in. How many of you have seen Matri Mandir here? Can you raise your hands? Baldev bhai? Nahi gaya aap? इस बार जाकर आना पड़ेगा आपको. हाउ कैन इट बी, आप लोग आते हैं पांडिचेरी, आप मातृ मंदिर नहीं देखते हैं, ऐसा है कैसा? इज अ बिट डिफिकल्ट, बट पहले से इंतजाम कर कराओ, यू मस्ट सी इट. व्हाट आई वांट टू टेल इज, वी ऑल गो टू मातृ मंदिर एंड ऑल ऑफ यू हैव सीन इज एक्स्ट्रा ऑर्डिनरी प्लेस. देयर इज अ थ्रिलिंग साइलेंस देयर. यू सिट डाउन almost religiously with that cushion back and front, looking at the crystal. Now, when you are looking at the crystal, what are you doing? You see, you are looking at the crystal, close your eyes, and that is the time when there is a free for all for the thoughts. Every damn thought comes in only when you sit at Matri Mandir or go to Samadhi. If I am at least talking to you, at least I know my thought is only Vishwabindu synthesis and yoga. The stupid ideas are not entering because my mind is blocked with this lesson. But the moment I sit for meditation, what mother calls is a bazaar of ideas. Some ideas say, my ideas are on sale, I'll give you 50% discount. Take me, somebody 90%, puja holiday. It's an absolute bazaar, cacophony. Sometimes you cannot stand the sound of this mind's bazaar. You would rather say, "But let me come out. Let me do some work." I mean, you get frustrated when you get meditation, when you go sit for meditation. But that doesn't mean you do not, you should not. But I'm saying the initial experience. So there also, I think, I do not know, each one of you have your own way. The best way to meditate at the time is at least you have a moment of silence to dip within and at least gather in all your action and say Ma at thy feet. You sort of dump it at her feet so she does what she wants. So utna to kar sakte hain, we don't have to go for silencing the mind. Please don't try silencing the mind. You know, the moment you say shut up and get out, the other fellow from the left side will come. So right side exit and left side entrance. Endlessly. So this is the what happens. So Aurobindo is telling us, at every point, give all of them as a offer them to the divine. Now what do we do offering them to the divine? Just say, Ma, you take my thoughts, you take my actions, you take my. No, there is a little prayer. Ma, I am offering this at your feet for purification, change and deliverance of the truth. You say, what all action I am doing is out of ego, I did. But it doesn't matter. All that I have done out of my ego, out of my ignorance, I put it in front of you so that you may purify that, so that you may change my impurities into purities, so that you may give me the shakti. This is very interesting. When I was a child and I used to write a few letters bothering the mother sometimes. But later, I used to write to her not only my letter, but then add a last sentence that give me the strength to accept what you are writing. You see, the human ego is so solidly in falsehood that even when the mother's letter came to me and said, do this, hey, yaar, mother is telling me too many things. I don't think I will. The vital ego comes out, resists. Sometimes it doesn't accept even when the mother is there in her own handwriting, gives me the letter. So then I understood the danger of the vital and the mental ego and said, Ma, give me the strength to accept your verdict. You see, that's also, there's a great grace. Otherwise, human nature is so terrible. You can reject the mother's thing also. So that's why we have got to be very careful for purification, change and deliverance of the truth. So add a line, italics and bold. Mother, I am giving you this for purification, for changing, to bring out the truth of this action. If I am working at Sakar, let Sakar's truth be manifested through me or through all of us. So there is a kind of a prayer for purification, prayer for change, prayer for deliverance. Otherwise, if we just throw it at her feet, she says, who is this? Why are we thrown? What do you want? There's no name and address. There's no return envelope also. How can I send you back the answer? So you have to send her with a stamped receipt letter, envelope. So she sends you back the answer. So all this is in a way to tell you, you offer with the parenthesis of purification and of what we say deliverance. And then he would say, next, another period in which we draw back and build a spiritual wall around us, admitting through its gates only such activities as consent to undergo the law of the spiritual transformation. This is the second step. First one, what did we do? Everything. Ulta, palta, sidha, everything, good, bad, everything we offered. Of course, with a prayer. Second step, in which we draw back and build a spiritual wall around us, admitting through its gates only such activities as consent to undergo changes. Which means now, you have to cut off. You have to build a spiritual wall means enclose yourself. In the beginning, you are open to the world. So everybody came. Everything came, every relation came. But then you have to tell your friends and society,
thank you for coming. So then you avoid people, avoid things, avoid all that. So slowly you encircle yourself with a limit that where only minimum of activities which consent to, as he puts it here, to change themselves. Such activities as consent to undergo the law of the spiritual transformation. You see, we are not great spiritual masters. So I cannot deal with all the vital forces. So I said, no, I will limit my life. I will not go to pictures, I will not see the TV, I will not see this thing. I will restrict my outer life. Because I do not have the strength. In the beginning I used to offer. But then he said, there must be a phase in sadhana where you close yourself. The doors are shut. The Chinese doors are closed. You do only that which helps you to go to the mother. And those actions which are transparent to the mother. And rest of the contact and speaking and nonsense and communication, he said, bahut ho gaya. I've talked to the world enough. Let it be cool. That's the second phase. But remember, that is not the phase of asceticism. That's very important. Don't think that you have to get into some room and lock yourself up and eat one meal a day and half a banana. That's not the way. But he's saying, restrict your activities to those activities which help you to move towards the divine. And then there's a third step. A third in which a free and all-embracing action, but with new forms fit for the utter truth of the spirit, can again be made possible. Now this is the last step. Last step, but I don't know how many of us can reach. Where a free and all-embracing action, this is very beautiful, I mean, I find it so significant. In the beginning you are open to the world. So, masti kar rahe aap, cinemas, friends, drinks, shopping and hotels. That is the commonest man, the most ordinary, who enjoys life, but who never offers to the divine. So, that is the commonest people, those who live for the sake of living and rituals and shastras and all. Go ahead. But you are not yet turned to sadhana. You are living a common moral, ethical life. Bhai, hamara kaam kar rahe hain, puja bhi ja rahe hain, temple also. Do it. But if you want to do sadhana, you have got to have a conscious restriction. In the beginning of the sadhana, you go there, you do the garden work, you do the typing work, you go there to give a lecture, you go there. Even you can go to visit some hotels. But the difference between that man and this man is that this man who is a sadhak is now offering everything consciously to the divine. Yesterday also I did that. A week before I did the same. I went to the restaurant, I went to the TV. But today, the same actions are now painted with a word called offering. So every little thing I'm offering. But 2 years back, I did the same thing, but I was in such an ordinary consciousness, I didn't offer. So today, the difference is, I'm doing the same things with a sense of offering. Offering with purification, number one. I can say zero, common man. Step one, the sadhak, who is constantly offering to the divine. Step two, you come to a situation where you want to be a loner, as we say. Because why is it it's a loner? Have you seen how a butterfly is made? How does it make? What is the process? Cocoon. Before the cocoon, what happens? Little tiny green insect, you know. Crawling on the leaves and biting here, eating there. That? Caterpillar. Worm. That caterpillar is going everywhere, eating this plant, eating that leaf, doing the masti of the life.
Second phase, it gets into cocoon. It cuts off from the world. All the activities, it has no connection with the world. It gets into a cocoon. But then third step, what happens?
Butterfly.
That caterpillar, that greeny, smiley little worm, whom we didn't even like to touch, that is the common man, you know, slimy, sticky fellow who is going around eating and drinking. But when you have this cocoon life of your stage of your life, then an ashram, a place, a little thing, a center, those are useful at the cocoon level. But even if you come to the ashram Pondicherry, you live there, and then you go to the Guwahati center, you go to Calcutta center, where are you staying? I'm in the ashram. What the hell are you doing? No, main khana pina kar raha hu, the TV hai, everything hai. Ashram ka jeevan achha hi chal raha. But you are supposed to be in the cocoon, no? In the name of Pondicherry, you have come here and doing the same thing that slimy caterpillar was doing. What's the big fun? So cocoon is a stage where you have got to cut yourself off. Physically. Not mentally I can cut myself off. But there is a kind of a physical withdrawal. Jo zarurat kaam hai, wohi karunga. Zarurat says, I have to go to my work, I will do my work. I have to go to plant my, water my plants, I will do. These are small works, but this so-called, what we say, cocooning is disconnecting with the society. And what's happening all this while? You are preparing the butterfly within. There is a transformation that's taking place. So the minimum activity is the caterpillar is getting into a new being, a change. Imagine that is the real physical transformation that Sri Aurobindo is speaking of. So the butterfly is made. And one day it bursts. And that is the third level where Sri Aurobindo is telling us. A third in which a free and all-embracing action, but with new forms fit for the utter truth of the spirit. Third level, we break down the cocoon, we break down the Chinese wall, we break down and say, I'm back. But when you're back to the society, you are the butterfly now. Not the crawling worm that everybody hates, everybody has problems with. Now you are the butterfly. People appreciate this. Look at the butterfly. What a beautiful color. Go from flower to flower, taking the pollen, sucking the honey. But it has come back to the world. But now it is light. It is spirited. It is as if it has got the form of the divine himself. So too in our sadhana, after the transformation, I don't expect that we get into physical transformation, naya butterfly ban gaya. No. The cocooning is the stage of your psychic contact. Where you are in quiet, sit in your room, see the sunrise, see the forest, walk in the forest, trying to be alone. There, the psychic being, you know, in Savitri, there's a line, I'll still misquote it, that one dips deep when life's cherished guests are left outside. You peep within. When life's cherished guests are left outside, that is the second position. All our relations, activities, all that you enjoyed, when life's cherished guests are left outside, then you have a peep within into the heart. And then the third stage, you are the butterfly. You don't crawl anymore like that caterpillar. You have the freedom of the spirit. You are light, you are flying, you are going around. But with a completely changed consciousness. Now everyone loves you. You love everybody. There's no quarrel, there's no hatred, there's nothing. The butterfly, you look at the butterfly, how it beautifully jumps from flower to flower. There's nothing to pull it back. But the caterpillar thinks of being pulled back because of its limitations. But that is a freedom we gain in sadhana.
What? In the cocoon stage, we have connected with our psychic being. It may not be, you will be completely, into the psychic spirit, but you have had the visions, a contact, and then a beautiful acquaintance. And then when you come out, the world is so different. You said till yesterday I was looking at the same man, but today, what we say in Hindi, nazariya badal jati hai. You look at a thing, but until last 2 years he was this, and now it's a different thing. You come to the same sakar, but it's no more that ignorant involvement. You are there doing the work, but the people around you themselves will see you as a butterfly. That means you are so transparent, so beautiful, so quiet, so calm, that wherever you go, they'll say, hey, this is a butterfly. That means this is a spiritual man. And that is what he did. He came back to the world, and you see, especially her, after 1926, till 1926, she was in the cocoon stage, not of sadhana, but not much of exposure. But after 1926, she built the ashram. She used to go to factories and harpa ground, sports ground and tennis ground. But before that, she didn't do any of that. She was there with the Sri Aurobindo in the rooms, quiet, helping people. But that is what we mean. We come out into life, enjoy life. But now, there is no impurity of the vital. There is no mindset, mental setup. So that is where Sri Aurobindo says, these things, however, will be decided by no mental rule but in the light of the soul within us and by the ordaining force and progressive guidance of the divine power that secretly or overtly first impels, then begins clearly to control and order, and finally takes up the whole burden of the yoga. So these are the beautiful three stages. So when we become a butterfly, life is changed. But there also you should not have a tag on yourself saying, I am in the third stage, I am in the second stage. No mental rules. That only you know what you are doing. You don't announce to the world, look, don't you see, do singh aa gaya mere upar, I am in the third level. Don't you see, my cheeks are golden yellow, my body is changing, like that. Keep quiet. Don't talk about it. Don't even share this thing with anybody. Because it is between you and your psychic being. So don't even speak about it. You are quiet. But just like the flower that is there attracts people. Our Lady Gayatri goes in the morning, plucks her a beautiful flower, gives it to the offering to the mother. So like that, be a fragrant flower in the society to whom people will come. For fragrance, for color, for advice. So that is, don't have any mental constructions or mental decisions. I am now in the third stage and nothing of that. Now it is important to know these three steps, because after that Sri Aurobindo takes up another important idea, which I'll go in brief. You see, while we are doing this sadhana part, the first stage, second stage, third stage, and if you are honest, we'll know at what stage we are. We don't have to show up to anybody. Then you know, I'm in the first stage. You know, what is your, Sri Ramakrishna saying, Dudha tamak kya khaja nakshanga? Am I right? Tamak, you know what is tamak? Tobacco and milk. Sri Ramakrishna used to say, these two cannot go together. But that's what our life is. We take milk, we take tobacco. We are the ordinary people, enjoy both. Let's be normal. I don't want to have any kind of a show saying,
hey Anand Reddy, aap second level mein pahunch gaye ho, third, who the hell? So this is where our humility, our honesty must come in. Please don't show off. So once we have this kind of a decision within myself, then Sri Aurobindo says, there are some other activities you must be careful about. What he says, there are two kinds of knowledge. One is the supra-intellectual knowledge, which concentrates itself on the discovery of the One. So those are, you know, discovery of the One, O capital. So those are the great people who have gone on the discovery of the Supreme Brahman, Ramana Maharishi, Ramakrishna, Sri Aurobindo, Vivekananda. Discovery of the One. But हम तो छोटे लोग हैं, ordinary people. We take milk and tobacco together. What is the work that we should do? Okay, we have seen the sadhana stages. But when he says you cut off yourselves from all these external things, what kind of activities should we continue? Most people would go to religion. He says, religion you must follow, because that is a Godward path. Or some people will say, I will go into philosophic knowledge, I'll read up lots of books. Sri Aurobindo books and this book and that book, you go to spiritual workshop here, all books are available. So you say, no, philosophy, I must know what everybody is saying, what are the different ideas. Philosophy is good, philosophical activity as it says, but when it did not separate itself or rarefied metaphysical heights from the knowledge that belonged to the practical world and the pursuit of ephemeral objects, then he would say, but that philosophical reading, when you have a good library, huge library, keep reading, it doesn't give you any experience. People have read Gita 22 times, Savitri 15 times, Life Divine 8 times. But then, have you gotten experience of that? It cuts you off from experience, from life and all that. So purely the pursuit of knowledge is also not recommended. Knowledge is required, but not an exclusive pursuit of knowledge. There has to be some experience, spiritual sadhana that must follow. So the second type of activity, as I said, religion. Tried to live alone on the heights. Its aim was rather to take hold of man's parts of life, even more than his parts of mind, and draw them Godwards. It professed to build a bridge between the spiritual truth and the vital and material existence. It strove to subordinate and reconcile the lower to the higher, make life serviceable, earth obedient to heaven. So some people will say, no, I'll take to religion. And I've seen a lot of colleagues who, after a certain phase, they say, now I become a religious person. I want to take to my religion. Be it a Jainism or a Buddhism or thisism or thatism. I have to go to temples now. Kya baat hui? Why are you suddenly going to the temples? No, you see, I've now reached my retirement and so, kuch to kaam kare, you know. As mother told me, it's only after you retire that you think of God. Before that, all the appointments and disappointments of life are there. You say, I'll go to God, go to Chardham. That's what Anand Reddy is doing this time. Go to Chardham after retirement. Very nice. But why are you doing all that? What is the function of religion? He simply tells us that it rather takes up man's parts of life. That means religion controls my life level, sends me to Chardham, sends me to this this festival that is coming up, sends me to Kolkata, etc. On the life plane I'm moving. But has the Gita changed your mind? Have the Upanishads changed your mental capacity or mental understanding of things? Religion attacks life. It never attacks mind. Out of the great veneration I take up Vivekananda's 150th anniversary, so let me read at least a book. I read it. But sir, what is the experience you have had? But whereas in religion, You go to this Tirthayatra, you go to this temple, there is at least a life movement is there. You know, going, coming, contacting, and there is a satisfaction of life. It doesn't change life, but some kind of a satisfaction is there. That I am a good Hindu, I am a good Christian, I am a good Muslim.
But he would say, it tries to do all that, but we don't go too far. And then it says, religion, leaving constantly its little shining core of spiritual experience, has lost itself in the obscure mass of its ever-extending ambiguous compromises with life. Sometimes you should really admire Sri Aurobindo's language, incredible. I mean, it's so precise, so strong. Look at this. Religion leaving constantly its little shining core of spiritual experience has lost itself in the obscure mass of its ever-extending ambiguous compromises with life. What has happened to religion? It has lost the original spiritual experience. What Christ said, what Buddha said, what Sri Aurobindo said, what Ramakrishna said. Whatever, at least we read the books, but nothing more than that. So religion has made itself into a brick temple and a cathedral. Very, very attractive, fantastic structures. But this ever-growing mass of ceremonies and rituals, we are forced to enter that. So it is like the eating the kernel and leaving the inner experience. So religion also is there, but Sri Aurobindo says that also doesn't leave you too far. Religion was driven to cut existence into two by a division of knowledge, works, arts and life. Life itself into two opposite categories, the spiritual and the worldly, religious and mundane, sacred and profane. I was just referring to that. So when you become religious, the first thing is, don't do this activity. Do that activity. So life itself is cut into two. Into men and women. Women cannot go to this temple, men can go there. So religion has brought a division into all our life. Be it society, be it individual, be it countries, be it nations. So he says that is not something that is going to deliver us. So, that is one thing. Now, the last thing is one thing I'll come back. But then there is the other question of people taking to another type of knowledge, that is altruism. I mean, a lot of people, they say, now I'm a religious man. Why? Because I'm helping philanthropy, helping society, offering this money, offering that house. Because that you think is a great religious gesture and you are becoming a purified man. But here, again, Sri Aurobindo doesn't quite approve of this altruism, philanthropy, humanitarianism. Service are flowers of the mental consciousness and are at best the mind's cold and pale imitation of the spiritual flame of universal divine love. Altruism, philanthropy, and you know, I've seen in many temples, you have offered a slab, you have offered 50,000 rupees for which there is a slab and your name and address and mobile number is there. So the God wants to call you, he has your mobile number is there. What have we done? In the walls, on the floor. Baba, bhai, I'm so humble that my name is written on the floor, people walk over that. I am a humble servant of God. But all that is humbug, mental notions. After giving that 5 lakhs and the stone, have you gone 50 billionth of a millimeter closer to God's consciousness? So he says, everything is an imitation, egoistic thing. You want to go and you have to write your name there. When we go to the pujari, I don't know, they do the account of a puja and they say, what is your gotram? You say, my gotram is this. So in your name, he does a puja. Are yaar, what is this? As if God knows you by name. The other day I was reading something. There was a discussion about the gender in the mother's class. Mother is telling, you think the divine looks at you as a woman or as a man? When I'm replying to you, she says, take the word of Tara. She says, when Tara asks me a question, do you think I'm answering Tara the female? She doesn't bother you are a Tara or you are Gara, Bara or anything.
Names don't matter. What they say is the inner psychic being, the soul.
So here, in all our humanitarianism everywhere, only the name is there. So this is a thing, unfortunate, but this is where many people have found solace. Now I become a religious man, I give money, I give help, I give the poor. This is what brings forth the false ego, the mental ego. It's better not to give, and at least you don't have that ego that I have given. That's why in Tirupati nowadays they have got a hidden hundi, there's no name, nothing. Drop the money. But nowadays it seems the government is so strict, even in the hundi you have to write your name and pata and mobile everywhere. So that they can catch you. If you're suddenly giving 50 million rupees, you say, beta, kahan se hai? What about your income tax? So now the rules are changing. You cannot dupe God. So Sri Aurobindo would say this, all this altruism, etc., have their role. You see, what we are looking at is from the sadhana point of view. Please remember, if you want to be an ordinary man, common man, achha chal raha zindagi chalna do. You are happy with your life? Thompy. Go ahead, do your... When the beggars, people go and feed the beggars. Kya ho raha hai? Because I go a step closer to the divine. But if that were so, I think we would all be already supramentalized. So, I mean, Sri Aurobindo is radical in the sense. While accepting the past, he says, move into the future. And for moving into the future, these are the prerequisites. If you don't want to do that, up to you. Madan Sri Aurobindo were very clear. He says, why have you come to Pondicherry Ashram? You have just come to have a good match, a good rasagulla. Because here the fish is very cheap. So it's a haven for Bengalis. You have come to eat fish, or eat to have masala. You have come here to do something with yourself. But most people forget why they came here initially. And then there are complaints. The problems. However, that's not my business. But what Sri Aurobindo is telling us is, we have to try to practice a little bit. He would say, as he said in the dining room, a drop of. What is it? People go to dining room here. Have you ever read any notice board there? A drop of practice is. Yaad to rakhe, I'm happy about that. A drop of practice is better than an ocean of theories. So the ocean is just behind you. Look at that. But drop of practice. I mean, that is an extraordinary message. So friends, if only we could do even that drop. Well, speaking about the dining room, yes, I know. Yeah, already dining room ka ghanti baj raha hai aapka stomach mein. So you want to go. And I have to leave you because you have to go. Otherwise, an extraordinary book. Well, we'll meet tomorrow and I don't know. I'm just going. I'm enjoying. And that's what is important, not how much we are doing, what we are doing. So come back tomorrow. On Darshan, of course, there's no class 21st. That will resume on 22nd.